Hey, welcome, friends, to worship. It's good to see all of you here together this morning. Today is a really special day, and I'm very excited for our time together and together with the Lord. Why is today special? Today we're doing something we've never, ever done as a church before. And if you're a newcomer this morning, you're going to experience something new that we've all never experienced before. And so I thank you for being here. Today what we're about to do is we're going to worship the Lord together, but this is our opportunity to hear about what God has been doing. We have an annual congregational meeting, and we're doing that right now. I'm calling that to order, but we're doing all these things within the context of worship today, and I'm very, very excited for all of you to hear from the staff, one of our mission teams, to hear from the deacons about the things that God has been doing and the call that God has been putting on our lives for the future. So welcome. Welcome to all of you who are here in town as guests, visiting family for Thanksgiving. It's so good to see all of you. Some of you are newcomers this morning, this thing, you know, church is something completely new for you, or maybe you're a little bit familiar. We're really glad that you have come for this morning. Here's what the scriptures say, and this really sets the tone for us for the rest of the day. Shout with joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of His name. Make His praise glorious. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. So great is your power that your enemies cringe before you. All the earth bows down to you. They sing praise to you. They sing praise to your name. Come and see what God has done. How awesome His works in man's behalf. And it's our joy, delight, and opportunity today, friends, to say how awesome are your deeds, O God. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. And Lord, we pray for your Holy Spirit to come and stir and work in us this morning, and have your way, do what you want done. Lord, we're going to hear from you, and we pray that our hearts would be stirred about what we hear, that we could get up and be a part of your gospel work here in Sheldon and the surrounding countryside, but Lord, across the seas as well as across the street. Lord, we are excited today to be here, to be able to choose new leaders, elders and deacons, who are going to lead and help serve this congregation. We're excited, and we pray that, Lord, you will have your hand at work in the selection of those. Lord, do as you wish. Have your way here. This we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Hey, friends, I've welcomed you. Would you turn to a neighbor behind you, in front of you, beside you? Welcome them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
One God and Father of all, who is over. over all, in all, and living through all.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rings, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me.
Will you pray with me? Dear Lord, we thank you for bringing us together this morning after a week of holiday. Lord, we thank you for giving us time in our week to take out of our busy schedules, to gather with friends and families, to think about all the incredible things that you've blessed us with. But Lord, we know that your grace doesn't end with one season, and so neither should our thanks. Lord, we pray that the thanks that we've been having all week long continues not only this morning, but every day of this year. The scriptures say that we're supposed to give thanks in every season. Seasons when it's easy to give thanks, when we have so much to be grateful for. We have plenty of food. We have all of our loved ones together in one room. But it also says to give thanks when we don't have a lot to offer, when we don't have much to praise for. And those are when it gets hard. So Lord, I pray that this morning we have that sense of joy, that sense of praise, and that we're here today to thank you for all that you have done and all that you will continue to do. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
All right. Well, today is a really, really good Sunday. We're going to, kids, just not quite yet you can leave for children worship. We got some things to share. Not quite yet. Well, friends, I'm so excited. I've shared with you in the last several weeks that, you know, today is kind of an experiment. And so nothing's obviously set in stone, but it's so good to see all of you here and to share this time of worship together with the Lord. I want to just bring a few things to your attention this morning. First of all, in your worship program, there is the Advent schedule for the whole year. What's going to be happening, you know, throughout the schedule, Christmas programs, Christmas Eve, you know, celebrations. Just take note of that and make use of those things. Another quick note, the Alpha Teens had originally scheduled to have two dates to sell those cookie jars. They make these, you know, those jars you fill with all the flour and the sugar and the ingredients for the cookies, and then you add your egg, you know what I'm talking about? Okay, they're only going to sell those on December 10th, all right? So just please make your plans accordingly, and they will go very quickly. So please take note of that. Now today, again, is a special day. Hopefully, if you are really interested in these things, you've got a little bit of a report through the end of October, and this is just for your information. Anything that you hear today about the things that God has done in us, through us, and you have questions about, you can certainly ask anybody who's up front, you know, who's reporting those things. I'm excited to share with you, you know, with our staff, some of the things that they're doing. So I want to invite up our staff members to, and I've told them, you know, take about 5 minutes to share about the things that God is doing. Now, why do we do this? Megan, why don't you come on up? Why do we do this? Because we need to be encouraged about the good things that God has been doing. You know, I say every Sunday morning, we're building God's kingdom one life at a time. Now, how is that actually happening? Megan, can you share a little bit with respect to youth ministry?
Yeah, so I'm going to share the highlight of my year, and then I'm just going to share a few things that are coming up with our youth. So the highlight of my year was definitely Rocky Mountain High. And the reason it was my highlight, not just of being a youth director, but really just in my life, was because Monday night after Stuart Hall got done sharing, we had three students. I heard them verbally surrender their lives to Christ, and me and Michael and Erica Jagger and Danielle got to be, you know, out in the moonlight, surrounded by mountains, listening to these three students pour their heart out to Christ, admit they need a Savior, and surrender. And that is like a very precious memory that I will carry with me for the rest of my life, just getting to be a part of that. So thank you for sending us. One really, really exciting thing we have coming up is earlier this month, Zach and I had the privilege to fly to South Carolina to check out a mission trip opportunity for our youth, but not just for our youth, for the church as well. That place is called Victory Ranch. It's run by missionaries Caleb and Chelsea Hinners, and it's in the Columbia area, and it's a 17 and a half acre ranch dedicated solely to serving the men and women in the military coming out of Fort Jackson by Columbia, and then also out of Shaw Air Force Base in Sumter, South Carolina. So we're going to be taking our youth there this summer. We're going to do work projects, and then we're going to minister to the military personnel coming to the ranch for retreats on the weekend and just pour into them and love them and serve them. And Zach and I got to do that when we were there, and we were just completely blown away by the ministry and what they're doing. And so we're just going to go and be there tangibly to help Caleb and Chelsea Hinners. So that's coming up for our youth. We don't have dates set yet. But we're really excited about that. Something else that's coming up that I actually want the church to be a part of with the youth is I've invited Rick Zomer. He works for the RCA to kind of bring congregations and youth together. And so he's going to be coming, and he's going to do like a training session almost on teaching about like teenagers and emerging adults and just how we can reach them, how we can disciple them, how we can mentor them, how we can partner with them in life and in the gospel. And so I'm really excited for him to come. And then I'm going to have somebody else come as well later. So just keep your eyes open for things like that. They'll be in the bulletin. That will be in January and February, most likely next year, because we really just need to surround these kids with love, and we need to take them under our wing and take responsibility for them and love them and pour into them while they're still here with us. So thank you for coming to the soup and pie supper. We served 302 people. I think that's the most we've ever served. So thank you for coming.
You said 302.
302, yeah. So thank you for coming and donating. Thank you to Eileen Fetters and Dee Van Beek and their work group. I don't know where they are, but they put together the soups.
They put some together good
soups. Yeah, the soups were amazing. Awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you for buying our frozen foods from our Alpha Teens. We're going to deliver those this Wednesday. And then, like Pastor Paul said, we're also doing the cookie jars on December 10th. So that's kind of what's coming up for us. So thanks for listening.
Sweet. Sweet. Megan, thank you so much. Yeah, and I was going to say it if Megan didn't say it, but thank you. Shelley, why don't you come up and share a little bit about discipleship, outreach ministry, what God's doing, and how we can maybe continue to be a part of that.
I am always amazed by the Lord's faithfulness. Are you amazed by his faithfulness? So many things to share. I just wrote down a few things. First of all, thank you to those of you who helped in any way with our Faith Weaver Friends Operation Christmas Child Boxes. When you guys take those lists off of the bulletin board and fill those lists, we put exactly enough items on there to fill 70 boxes. We filled 84 boxes. So the Lord was faithful in his strange way of multiplying things to turn our 70 boxes into 84. Those are going to go out all around the world and bless children. They'll hear the gospel and have the opportunity to take a 13-week-long journey. It's called The Greatest Journey. It's a discipleship program, so thank you. Children and worship. We consistently this year have had 12 to 17 children and worship. That is really exciting. This summer, we did a family faith festival, and then that was a community-wide thing, and that went right into our vacation Bible school. We really did some challenging curriculum this summer. If you were involved in vacation Bible school, you know that it wasn't our typical curriculum. We did Paul and the Underground Church, and our kids were exposed to some really challenging things about the early church and how being a Christian was not popular. And I just felt like that was some depth that we had. I am so thankful for our volunteers in our children's ministries. Year after year, I used to really worry and get anxious about finding enough volunteers, and I have just learned to rest in the Lord's faithfulness. I don't want to be the person you see in the grocery store and avoid because you're afraid I'm going to ask you to help with something. I let the Holy Spirit do that work, and the Lord has been faithful to bring about all of our volunteers year after year, so thank you. Those of you who volunteer in our children's ministries, you are truly fulfilling a calling. The Lord has been faithful with that. I want to give a praise report to the Lord this year for our high school Sunday school classes. We pray every year for good attendance in our high school Sunday school classes. Kids get busy, and for a number of reasons, it seems like attendance drops off in those 9th through 12th grade years. Folks, this is the best attendance we have had in a very long time. And it's so important because this is the cognitive level where kids can start processing and understanding terms like sanctification and glorification, bodily resurrection from the dead. Those are really important things. And so I want to thank you, students and parents, for being faithful to Sunday school. And I want to thank our Sunday school teachers again. Outreach stuff. We have had a turn of events this year. One of our major outreach focuses has always been the RTF. And that no longer exists. So we have been seeking the Lord, what he would have us do in that area, and we have shifted our focus to students at NCC. So it's a little rocky right now. We're not exactly sure what we're doing and what direction we're going, but that's the direction we feel like the Lord is leading us. Some other fun things that we've done this year and the Lord's been faithful in. Every February, this congregation hosts the Sheldon Unity Meal. So we will do that again this upcoming February. This past April, we hosted a movie night, God's Not Dead, and I believe we had about 130 in attendance at that. Our Labor Day parade, we just do something really simple. We just simply hand out pencils along the parade route that say God loves you.
3,000 pencils.
3,000? What are we shooting for this year?
We're shooting for 5,000 this year. So, I'm serious, people. We can do that.
Yeah. So
I wish we could do 10,000.
It's everybody fun. Gets a pencil. And then those pencils filter into the schools, and yeah, it's just a witness of God's love. The Sportsman's Banquet this past year, again, the Lord was faithful and brought 400 people to the Sportsman's Banquet to hear the gospel message very clearly articulated, so that was excited. And this just this past week, our Thanksgiving meal, we hosted 160. So thank you all for your part in the Lord's faithfulness, and praise be to God for his faithfulness.
Awesome, awesome. Yeah, I'm pretty pumped about those pencils. I gave my Wednesday night Bible study the challenge. I want you to provide such that you can give half of that. So our goal is 2,500 pencils. That's a little less than 20 cents a piece. But don't you want every kid in Sheldon School District or in whoever comes, I want every kid to have one of those pencils that says, you know, First Reformed Church, God loves you. Do you want one of those in your school, at your kids' desks? Okay, I'm not the only crazy one. Thank you, Shelley. Emily, we're Emily. Oh, there you are, Emily. Why don't you share a little bit? Now, Emily's new to us. We've just been blessed with your beautiful voice and organizational skill and music skill. But Emily, you know, share a little bit about music ministry, but a little bit about you too.
Sure. So I realized this week that I've officially celebrated my 1 month anniversary. So I just want to say thank you to all of you who have introduced yourself or made me feel really welcome. It has not gone unappreciated. I've only lived in Iowa for probably about 5 months.
It's
I moved here from
live,
Cedar Rapids, so it's been a really great welcome.
We love Iowa.
I can't really share a lot about what has happened with the music program in the past, but I can share a little bit about what is happening in the future. And before I do that, I just want to explain a little bit. When I say the music ministry program, that includes second service worship team, who were kind of the members you saw today. That also includes our organists, that includes choir, bells, our tech teams who are running our service this morning. I always forget a group decorations team. And then we're also starting a first service worship team, a group of hymn leaders to help lead that as well. So if you're involved in one of those groups, can you please stand for me? I didn't tell them I was going to do this. So these are the people who are part of this ministry. This is the ministry right here. It's not me, it's all of these guys. So I just want to say thank you to each and every one of you guys for being part of this team when I wasn't here. So thank you. You guys can sit down. We're always looking for people to join us. I promise that I will be the newest one there if you do. So if you are interested in being part of any one of those groups that I just mentioned, please let me know. Also, if you're interested in maybe learning to play guitar, you've never done that before, you're interested in learning piano, we're going to start a training program to help you do that and be part of this ministry up here. And then the big thing that we're really working on is all those groups are starting to work on Christmas music, and we're excited to present that for Christmas Eve service. So those are kind of the biggest things coming up.
In Jefferson City, Missouri, correct?
Yes.
But your family has connections. What's the town in Kansas?
Tonganoxie.
I think the Palin family has some origins there too.
Yes, Palin's mom taught my mom and dad English.
And your parents now live in Cedar Rapids.
Yep.
And it was, here's how Emily and us came together. Emily was the intern while my sister was on her maternity. Now my sister does what Emily does for us at her church in Cedar Rapids, and that was kind of the connection. And I tell you what, she couldn't have had anybody better. You couldn't have had anybody better than my sister, if I can just boast a little bit.
That's true.
All right. Well, we really appreciate you. What else would we want to know about you, Emily? Like, maybe your favorite pie. Everybody knows my favorite pie now.
It's a tie between pecan and lemon meringue. Mm. Those are my two favorites.
All right. Christmas is coming. All right. Well, Emily, we're just really glad that you have chosen to be with us, and really appreciate all of your service with us. Thanks so much. If you have any questions about Shelley, from Emily, or from Megan, you just ask them afterwards. I'm going to invite Jamie to come up. Jamie's going to come and share a little bit about missions team, and then I got a couple of other just quick notes, and we'll move on to God's word for us this morning. So Jamie, why don't you share?
Just so you know, I am not on staff. I don't get paid like these other ones, but I'm fortunate enough to be one that gets to come up and talk to you. If 3 years ago, when I first became a deacon, I got put in the missions team. Like many of you, I wasn't aware of what the mission team was, what happens. Every once in a while, we have missionaries come here, and they talk to us, and you get that feeling like, oh, great, we got to listen to another missionary. This will be good. And then you sit through the service, and then you leave and say, phew, that one's done. But really getting involved with the mission of the church and what the mission of the church is really important. You can see that board back there. All the missions that we support a ton of missionaries around the world. That's a good thing. And you can read about them. We try to keep that updated with different letters that they get through the newsletters, things like that, which is all good. I challenge you to keep up with that. The other thing I want to pretty much talk about more is what this church does for missions. What is our passion? What do we look for? Haiti has been a good one. When did we start going to Haiti? I don't remember. Somebody shout that out. 83, 86, somewhere, early 80s.
That's is that right, Phil? 86? When did we first start going to Haiti? 82.
We'll go with 82. Right, that's a good number. That's a long time to be heading to Haiti in a mission, so we're pretty passionate about it. Brenda goes to Mexico. She's pretty passionate about that Mexico trip. Yep. So she's pretty passionate about that. That's great. Rise on the Road, we send youth down to Rise on the Road, and I love that Emily's getting our youth involved in more missions. That's great. College mission trips, we send a lot of kids out through Northwestern, different mission trips there. That's really good. Harvey and so, and Bruce, they went to Africa this year to work with some dairy farmers out there. We've had a couple go to Compton, California. That's a new one that can be done. Victory Ranch is the one that we're setting up. Sportsman's Banquet, that's a huge one that the church sports. A lot of volunteers with that one. Rice Fest, again, is another one that this church is involved with. Lots of volunteers. Thanksgiving meal. I don't know how many we served there. Did you say that already this morning?
What did we say? 160-some?
160-some people we served and could be a witness to there. NCC is becoming a focus. There's all kinds of things that this church is involved in. So if you're not involved in a mission, there's all kinds of ways to get involved. I just think of Haiti because I have a passion for Haiti, but been there. This would be the fifth year going there. So of the 5 years I've get of all the new people that have gone and taken part of the A trip there is unbelievable. So the guys that started in 1982, 1983, that seed has been planted, and we're getting new generation to get involved with that ministry. That's awesome. Way to build on that. That's what mission is. It's planting the seed. It's not about coming home from a mission trip and saying, you know what? I made 3 people a Christian this week because I was there. That's really shouldn't be the goal. The goal should be to plant that seed and let the Holy Spirit, when we're not there, work in their spirit. That way when we come back the next year, we can build that relationship and keep that thing going. So I ask that you get involved in a mission as we look forth in this next year to expanding the mission of the church, getting more healthy missional, all that. Get involved in something. Get passionate about something and get that fire in your heart to burn on something. And so there's great things coming with the mission. So
great. Thanks. Here, I'll take that, Jamie. Good. Thanks. Hey guys, thanks for so much for sharing. Isn't it good to hear some of the good things that God is doing, friends? We say we're building God's kingdom one life at a time. Now we get to hear a little bit about it. It's wonderful. Just another quick little staff update. Pastor John has been our calling pastor this last year. He has to pull away from that position. Pastor John, we appreciate the service that you have rendered unto us and the care that you have given to many people within the congregation who are shut-ins. He's kind of been my help when I can't get to the hospital sometimes, and sometimes we've met at the hospital together too sometimes. Hey, can we just give not only praise and thanks to the Lord for what John's done, but our thank you for John with a little round of applause. Thank you, John. He's a delight to have at our staff meetings. I appreciate the wisdom of his years, and he's just a really funny guy too. But I get so many people saying to me, that Pastor John, oh, he's good. I really like him. He's a special guy. Thank you, John, for your service that you have done. Well, all right, good. Well, we're going to turn our hearts to God's word for us this morning. And now, kids, if you're 4 years older in kindergarten, you can go with Mrs. Brenda in the back. She's waiting for you. Parents, you can bring your kids down to room, or you can, excuse me, she'll bring your kids down to room 21 in the basement. You can pick them up in room 21 in the basement as well. I need to make sure that you know that we need to pray for a couple people. I want you to remember to pray for Jan DeGroat. We're going to pray for these people here after the message. Pray for Jan. Her cancer's returned, all right? You're exploring their treatment options for that. Continue to pray for Tom Mao. Tom is receiving continued treatments. But we also need to pray this morning. This isn't in your worship program. We need to pray for Myrtle Corbine on Thursday afternoon, right before we were leaving for some family time. Norma, her daughter, called me, and Myrtle had a very serious stroke. And I don't know any more information than that, but other than she wasn't very responsive. And I'm sad about that because Myrtle is such a wonderful woman and so fun to visit. And I know Norma, Bob, and the whole family are quite discouraged. So let's remember to pray for them, and we'll do that at the conclusion of our message together. So this day is a special day, friends. It's a special day. Because, you know, we get to hear about what the Lord has done. We get to be encouraged about some things. And I want us to take a little time to look back and look forward with this reason in mind. When we tell about the things that the Lord has done, it causes us to trust Him in the future. And that's really where we're going here this morning. Telling what the Lord has done is critical to our future trust in Him. Would you turn with me in your copy of the Scriptures to Exodus chapter 12, and we're going to read verse 21 through verse 30. When I was a kid, one of the special things I was able to do, and perhaps some of you had that same experience, was to sit down with dinner with my grandparents every Sunday. Loved it. Of course, I loved my grandma's fried chicken. I loved my grandma's chocolate cake. I loved my grandma's spaghetti. I loved my grandma's dried beef gravy. I loved everything my grandma made except for peas and lima beans. I did not like those. Everything else, that's good. But what was so wonderful is sometimes we told stories about the Lord, but they told stories about the way things used to be and how things were done, about people and days and ways that of old that have gone past. And in those stories, there's some stories of faithfulness. Some stories are just stories to be told of people, when and where they used to live and what they used to do. And those stories are important to tell. But how much more so the stories about what God has done in our lives. I did a little research, and I want to share at least one story with you in a little bit about what God had done in the past in this congregation. And I'm sure none of you who are here today were alive then. So you'll know this may be a completely new story. What we're going to see here in the Scripture is the exhortation from the Lord to us through the experience of the people of Israel to tell what the Lord has done. Let me give you the backdrop of what we're about to read, okay? So the people of Israel had been in Egypt for now, 400 years. God calls this man Moses to go and lead his people out of Egypt and into the promised land. The Lord does this through a series of 10 plagues. The last plague was a serious one that brought upon the death of every household of the firstborn. But the Lord provided a means by which His people could be saved from that plague. And they were to take some hyssop, which is just a plant, a particular plant, and the blood of a lamb and spread that blood above the doorframe. Okay? And that was a sign to this, to the angel that was moving through to carry out this plague to pass over that door and the people inside would be saved. So we're at this point. Moses is giving the instruction to the people of Israel to do this because God's about to deliver them. And with this plague, He does bring about their deliverance. Pharaoh, who's in charge of the land, finally relents and said, okay, go. But in the middle of this story, there's a key truth for us to know. That is to tell what the Lord has done. And that's where we're going to go today, because telling what the Lord has done is critical to our future trust in Him. So let's put our eyes to the page. Exodus chapter 12, verse 21. We're kind of picking up the story, but I think I've given you enough background information. Then Moses summoned all the elders of Israel and said to them, "Go at once and select the animals for your families and slaughter the Passover lamb." That's where they get the blood. "Take a bunch of hyssop, dip it into the blood in the basin, and put some of the blood on the top and on the both sides of the door frame. Not one of you shall go out of the door of his house until morning. When the Lord goes through the land to strike down the Egyptians, he will see the blood on the top and sides of the door frame and will pass over that doorway. And he will not permit the destroyer to enter your houses and strike you down." Verse 24, "Obey these instructions as a lasting ordinance for you and your descendants. When you enter the land that the Lord will give you as he promised, observe this ceremony. And when your children," now listen now, "and when your children ask you, 'What does this ceremony mean to you?' then tell them, 'It is the Passover sacrifice to the Lord who passed over the houses of the Israelites in Egypt and spared our homes when he struck down the Egyptians.' Then the people bowed down and worshiped. The Israelites did just what the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron. At midnight, the Lord struck down all the firstborn in Egypt, all the firstborn of Pharaoh who sat on the throne, to the firstborn of the prisoner who is in the dungeon, and the firstborn of all the livestock as well. Pharaoh and all his officials and all the Egyptians got up during the night, and there was loud wailing in Egypt, for there was not a house without someone dead." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Larry, pray us in, please.
Will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, bring the Holy Spirit upon us today as we listen to the message.
Yes, Lord.
With Pastor Paul, as he brings it to us. And remember, we have a lot to be thankful for this church and everything that's done for us.
Yes, Lord.
And thank you again for this message. You ask us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Telling what the Lord has done is critical to our future trust in Him. We have this saying, our mission statement as a church, building God's kingdom one life at a time. And God has been doing that in the past, whether this was our official mission statement. If you read through the history of our church, you see that God was doing this one life at a time, sometimes a family at a time. God has been working. Has been at work. He has been in the past, and He will be in the future. He was at work in the people of Israel, and He's going to be at work within us in the future that we have together as well. So let's get a look at this text and unpack it. I gave you the information. You know, their Passover is happening. This is what the Lord brings about to finally bring the deliverance of His people. But there's going to come a day when new babies are born, and families are sitting around celebrating this Passover. And kids are going to ask, "Mom, Dad, why do we do this?" Maybe you had this experience with one of your new kids, you know, who's kind of grown up and figured out, "Oh yeah, at Thanksgiving we have turkey, and at Thanksgiving we eat pumpkin pie." Did anybody ask, any kids in your family ask, "Why do we eat turkey and Thanksgiving or pumpkin pie?" Did anybody ask that? Well, they teach that at school. That's what the pilgrims ate, or at least so we think, all right? That's why we do, to remember that first Thanksgiving, but it's also a traditional meal that we share together to remember, because a new generation is going to be born, and they need to be taught about the past. And God senses this. He sees, when you enter the land, verse 25, that the Lord will give you as He promised, observe this ceremony. And when your children, it's not if your children, it's when your children ask you, because they're going to ask, "Mom, Dad, why do we do this? Why do we do this whole ceremony?" Tell them, "It is the Passover sacrifice to the Lord who passed over the houses of Israelites in Egypt and spared our homes when He struck them down." Telling is the most important thing. That brings us to our first truth note, friends, that we need to see. Telling what the Lord has done is critical, absolutely critical, to our future trust in Him. If these kids of the people of Israel don't know what the Lord has done in the past, are they going to trust Him in the future? They need to know it so that they can know Him. And in knowing Him, so that they can trust Him. And then so trusting him that they can remember, you know, what he has done, and so that they can trust him into the future. You follow that? They need to know about what has happened. Well, this great thing that God has done. Now, listen, if you had been in slavery for 400 years, and that's all that you and your people knew, this would be a wonderful thing. This is a great thing that God has done. We're not just talking about like 10 people here. We're talking, you know, a million-ish people who were slaves in Egypt. And God brings about their deliverance. And he gives them the Passover ceremony, or Passover meal and all that's involved, so that they'll remember. But there will come a generation from now that won't remember because they didn't experience it. And they'll have that ceremony, and the kids will ask, now why? Future generations need to know to trust him. They need to know about this event so that they can know him who delivered his people out of Egypt, and to know him so they can trust him, trusting him so they can remember what he has done, so that they can trust him into the future. It's absolutely critical for our future. Trust in him. And this is the second truth note. God commands telling what he has done because it is critical for the children to know it. And this is why grandparents are so important. Because grandparents have a little more memory stored up. You know, mom and dad have some really cool stories, but they're just that much closer to their kids. Grandma and grandpa stretch a little further back in time, and they've seen a few more of the patterns of behavior. I can remember talking to my grandma or grandpa sitting down at Sunday dinner, and I said, "Grandpa, I'm thinking about living at this place in this fraternity in college." And I remember my grandpa saying, "Are you sure that's wise? That doesn't sound like a good idea." Because he'd been around the block a few times. He'd seen the patterns of behavior. This is why grandparents are so important. And you need to make sure you give your kids all the opportunity and time to spend with their grandparents. They need to know them. Because the kids need to know what the Lord has done in their past so that these kids can know him and trust him, and remember all that he's done, and remember and to be able to trust him into the future. Because what would happen if the parents didn't tell the kids? What do you think? They'd forget. They wouldn't know. And they wouldn't know the Lord. It's absolutely critical. So this is why the Lord commands his people. And throughout the scriptures, we see the same thing. You know, he's either commanding, remember to tell them, or tell them, remember to tell what the Lord has done. Psalm 66, tell of his excellent deeds on man's behalf. This is all the things. God continually exhorts his people all throughout Scripture to tell of the things that he has done. When we look at the future, you know, you'll remember what Jesus said. You know, we all gather here. There's a table. On top of the table, there's shiny plates, some big ones, two small ones, okay? On the front of that table, it says, do this in remembrance of me. Why? Why remember? Because we forget, and it's important to remember. You see the pattern? It's all throughout Scripture. Tell of the excellent things that the Lord has done. It's all throughout Scripture, and we need to know it. So when we come, we remember Jesus' body was broken when we have that bread in our hands. We remember when we have that little teeny tiny cup of juice. I know it isn't much, but we don't need much to remember that Jesus died on the cross. And that represents, symbolically represents, his blood that was shed for us that takes away our sins. Amen? Truthfully, I didn't get the connection between that meal and what Jesus had done till I was probably about in college. Probably about in college. Now, some of you have parents, and when we pass the plates, you take out a little piece of bread, and we pass the cup, you take out a little cup of juice. And some of you have your kids, you've asked, your kids have said to you, "Can I have some?" They think it's snacks in church. This is awesome. Okay? I remember thinking the same thing. When they ask you, what should you do? You tell them. You tell them so that they can remember, so that they can know what happened so that they can know him, so they can trust him, so they can remember him, so they can trust him in the future. We need to tell our kids. God commands us, telling what he has done. It is critical for our children to know it. But then there's this last little piece too. Our telling what the Lord has done is critical for our remembering so that we trust him. So that we trust him. Now I'm going to jump several centuries in the future. What we read here in Exodus chapter 12 was about 400 to 1500 BC. So that's 1400 to 1500-ish years by our scholars' best, you know, estimations before Jesus arrives on the scene. I want to jump ahead to Acts chapter 7. You don't need to turn there. I'm just going to give you a synopsis. Now, this is just perhaps months after Jesus has died. And there's a great brouhaha that has arisen because, you know, the Spirit of the Lord has fallen upon everyone who believes in Jesus. And the testimony about Jesus is spreading and people are coming to believe. In Acts chapter 7, we read the story of a man named Stephen. Stephen was a believer in Jesus. And the Lord had come upon him in the particular moment and began to share with the whole crowd all that God had done. Remember, you know, telling is an important and critical part of our future trusting in him. He was telling all that the Lord had done, all that the Lord had done to with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, you know, the patriarchs of the people of Israel. All that the Lord had done through Moses and bringing them out of Egypt into the promised land, through the Red Sea, providing man in the desert, the law coming down from the Lord on Mount Sinai. All these things, and it all points to one person. It points to Jesus, and he makes that connection for us. But here's the thing. Those people who heard the message, they didn't want anything to do with Jesus. They wanted everything to do with what was the past. They didn't want anything to do with what the present or what was the future. Our remembering, Stephen's remembering, Stephen's telling was to point people to Jesus so that they would trust in him. So that they would open their lives, their hearts to him. It's absolutely critical. Now, some people won't because their hearts are hard and they're so tied up into their power structure, you know, the religious power structure, they won't let it go. But some do, and some come to believe. We have to tell what the Lord has done so that we can trust him into the future. We have to tell. So that to know the past where God has been faithful. 1911. Anybody know what happened in 1911? Well, before that, how about this? When you walked in the doors this morning, did you see this little lit up sign that said 1895? Anybody see that? Some of you have been walking through these doors, you don't even really notice it anymore. Do you know why it says 1895? Some of you do know. It says 1895 because that was when this congregation was started. In 1895. So how many years is that? Are we out from that? 122 years this congregation has been established. In 1911, a decision needed to be made. And in 1911, the church did not exist on this present property. It was at another property here in Sheldon. And a decision needed to be made. An inquiry was made of the Baptist church in town, you know, in their present building. This congregation was renting it on Sunday mornings for $1. Yeah, $1. They made an offer to buy the building for $1,000. Okay, isn't this amazing how times have changed? They made it, but the Baptist church didn't want to sell. So we have to make a decision. Do we expand their present building? And believe me, the present building was really just kind of a, you know, rectangular building, didn't really have much. You know, it was enough space for people to sit down, not really to gather anywhere. But the church was growing so quickly, something needed to be done. And in 1911, decision was made. There was an empty lot on the corner of 7th Street and Washington. Right here, where we're at right now. Let me read you the story. The church membership continued to grow, and it was soon realized that they needed a larger building. What makes the church membership grow? The Lord does that. I was soon realizing he had a church building. The lot on the corner of Washington Avenue and 7th Street was purchased for the sum of $1,050, if only that were today. And plans were made to build at this location. Two committees were formed to solicit funds from the members as well as from friends and the businesses of Sheldon. This is amazing. Listen to this. The drive was successful. The members pledged $4,500, and the town folk, people from the community, get this, they gave $1,610. They weren't even members of the church. We just want to contribute to make that happen. Who does this stuff? Who said that? Yes, the Lord does it. Molly, thank you. Who convinces people from the community to give to a church they don't even belong to make it built? The Lord does this stuff. We got to tell these stories. Okay, it gets better. The Reformed Church Board gave $2,000. That's from the main offices of the RCA. Gave $2,000, and now the total was $8,1100. The church cost $9,925, all right? You all just spent, some of you bought a new car this past year, and you probably paid at least double, if not triple, that amount for the church building. A parsonage was also built for $3,500. It was located to the west of the sanctuary and faced 7th Street, approximately where the youth house is today. The old church and parsonage were sold for $2,000. The new structures were finished on April 25th, 1912, and dedicated on May 16th, 1912. After all the costs were included, the church now had a debt of $7,000. This was considered a large debt, but the church continued to grow in spirit and membership under the leadership of Reverend Vandernault. Okay, all of this is to say the Lord has been faithful in the past to this congregation. Where did that $7,000 debt get taken care of? Absolutely. But they saw, we are going to need to grow for the future. And did you know this little lot on the corner of 7th and Washington? It was on the edge of town, right, Phil? Across the street where the parsonage is today, that was just an old farmhouse. Larry and Eileen, your house was over there too. It's around the corner today, but it was over there. And everything east of here was all fields. In fact, do you know why Kaler Court is kind of crooked? If you drive down Kaler Court, it's crooked. Did you notice that? Do you know why? Because it used to be a pasture, and they just built the street to follow the lanes of the pasture. You know, where a guy would drive his wagon back there. That's why it's crooked. I don't know why they did that, but they did, but it's done now. Okay? Do you realize, and I don't know if the people at the time knew what they were doing, if there was any intention. I think they saw an open lot, but they saw this church being built on the edge of the community where it would be a visible presence to all, not smack dab in the middle. And whether the Lord used the events of, you know, not being able to buy the Baptist church, and the Lord used the events of, you know, coming to stir in people's hearts, we got to build a building. However he did it, and the means that he did it, he said, we're going to choose this place, this lot to do it. Now, if that original building was built out here right on the grassy knoll. In fact, in the summertime when it gets really dry, you can still see the old footings that are in the ground. They did not take those out. They still exist. It's because some people decided one day we're going to take a risk. They decided one day it's going to take some debt, but we know it's worth it in the end. And the story is that God has been faithful. And he continues to be faithful. Every time the people of Israel would sit back and have the Passover meal, it was an opportunity to look back on God's faithfulness in the past and his trustworthiness then, to trust him into the future. Every time we read a little bit of the history of this congregation, it's an opportunity to say, the Lord has been faithful in the past. We can trust him in the future. Somebody decided, we got to take a risk. And it cost them. $7,000 was a lot of money in 1911, 1912. But was it worth it? Without it, where would we be today? I don't know. So they faced some of the same questions that we would face. You know, where are we going to get the money? What kind of building are we going to have? Are we going to have oak pews or walnut pews? You know, okay. Who knows, whatever they had. Is it going to be ash? You know, they face those kinds of monies. You know, in fact, they even face some cultural influences. We have our own cultural influences today that make us concerned and get us worried. In 1922, is anybody old enough to remember Pastor Gene this. Now, I'm not asking you to raise your hand. Okay, a few of you. I didn't ask you to raise your hand, but a few of you remember him. Thel and Alma, I think he married you, didn't he? Okay, 1922, he's a fresh pastor. The Ku Klux Klan was coming to Sheldon. This is in our church history. And the decision needed to be, are we going to be a part of that or not a part of that? Pastor Gene didn't stand in this spot, but over in the old building and preached against it. That is not right. Now, some people left the church over that, but it was the right thing to do. The absolute right thing. There are cultural influences then, and there are cultural influences that threaten us today. But friends, has the Lord been faithful in the past? I didn't hear a really loud yes. Okay, thank you. I'm getting a little riled up here. You need to help me out. Yes, and will he be faithful in the future? Yes, he will. We need to tell what the Lord has done, because it's critical to our future trust in him. Past generations trusted him, and we're here today. Someday my prayer is that pastor, they'll say of us, past generations trusted him, and that they will be where they are with him in the future. So here's what we need to do. Here's what we need to do. We're looking back, but we're also looking forward. I realize our society is changing, our culture is changing, and that creates anxiety within all of us. But it also creates an opportunity. We're pioneers, friends. We're pioneers on new ground. Okay? Osceola County was the last county in Iowa to be settled. Did you know that? If you head out on Highway 18, and I don't remember which road it is. Somebody remind me. Where they have that little historical marker. Have you ever stopped to read the historical marker? Most of us just kind of pass right on by. They tell the story how they measured out, you know, your farmer's fields and where your plot of ground was using a wagon wheel with a little flag on it to measure it out so they knew where to go. This place was the last place in Iowa to be settled. There were pioneers who went before us. We're going to trust God. Did they have a lot of questions? Did they have, you know, complete and certain knowledge of the future? Probably not. But they trusted in the Lord. The people who started this church, did they have a lot of questions? Did they know where all the money was going to come from? Did they know what they needed to build? Did they know what the future was going to be? They didn't know, but they were going to trust in the Lord. And friends, we're coming into certain similar times. We don't know what the future is going to be. We're pioneers in new ground. Our society is one generation away. Literally, in Northwest Iowa, we are one generation away from losing any cultural memory of Christian faith or belief. And what I mean by that is people don't know, oh yeah, maybe my grandma used to go to church on Christmas and Easter, but nah, we don't know. We're that close. In some places in North American society, North America, our world, it's gone. People have no clue what Christmas is about, Easter is about, let alone about the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's gone. We are on new ground, and we're pioneering in new ways, which causes us to use a lot of things we have in the past, let go of some things from the past, and create new things for the future. It is uncertain. But has God been faithful in the past?
Yes.
Will he be faithful in the future?
Yes,
yes he will. And we've had a team of people over the last 2 years working a strategic ministry plan, and that's going to come to light. In January, I'm going to start teaching it and preaching it in January. Next month, or next Sunday morning, we begin this season of Advent. We remember the birth of Jesus. In January, we begin moving down the direction towards the plan that God has for us. Do we know all the details of what it's going to take? No, we don't. But we know God is faithful in the future. We do know that. We're pioneering on new ground, and it's going to be scary. Some of us won't want to go. Some of us will go because our friends will drag us along kicking and screaming. Some of us are saying, I can't wait, let's do it. But the fields are ripe with harvest. Are we going to jump in, or are we going to be back and say, I'm afraid? What did the people of this congregation say when they had to take on debt of $7,000? Did they say, we're afraid? No, they didn't. They said, let's do it. So let's put this word into practice in our lives, and I'm going to have Jamie and Scott come up here in just a little bit. Here's the first thing. This is really important, and just sort of a side note. I want you guys to create an autobiography of all that the Lord has done in your life so that you can tell your children and your grandchildren. They got to know it so they can know Him. They need to know Him so they can trust Him. Trust Him to remember the good that He has done so that they know they can trust Him into the future. Create a little autobiography. Now, I'm not saying write a book, even just bullet points. But tell your kids and your grandkids what the Lord has done for you. I mean, you don't have to tell them all the nitty-gritty bad stuff. Give them enough detail to know that, you know, it was bad. But tell them what the Lord has done. They need to hear it. Grandparents, sit down with your grandkids. Take them out to ice cream. While they're eating their ice cream, they're not going to be interrupting you. Okay? You're going to be eating their ice cream. Tell them. And they will remember those stories for a long, long time. Kids, grandkids, listen to your mom and dad. Okay? The Lord says obey your parents. Grandkids, listen to your grandparents. They've got wisdom to share with you. They have stories to tell what the Lord has done in their lives. I want you guys to create an autobiography. Here's the next thing. I want you to be open to the Lord's future for First Reformed Church. We are pioneering on new ground in our nation and our culture. It's going to cause us to look back on the resources that God has given us in the past, theological, material resources, all these things, okay, and use those. There's going to need to be some things we need to let go of because they're not going to be helpful for us. And there's going to be some things that we're going to need to create. Do we know all that's going to be? No, we don't. But there were people who had some uncertainty who started this church in the past. And they knew that God was certain and they could trust Him. I want you to be open to God's future for First Reformed Church and not sit back, dig heels in, say, I'm not going there, because we're pioneering new ground and it's scary. Believe me, it's scary. But God has been faithful in the past. You've said that, right? And He will be faithful in the future. I want you to let your heart be open. And I wanted to ask, this is just sort of a self-evaluation question for you this morning. Ask yourself this question. What is more important, my comfort or people believing the gospel? What's more important to you? My comfort. I like this. I like that. I want this. I want that. What's more important, your comfort or people believing the gospel? You know what's really important for me? People believing the gospel. But you know what always fights against that in me? The things I like that make me feel good. And we all got it, friends. I'm honest. We all got it. What's more important to you? And with that, I hope that your heart may be open to the future that God has for you and your contribution to building God's kingdom one life at a time here. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's pray. And Lord, so let our hearts be opened unto You. And let us please have Your way and do what You want done in us. You've been faithful, Lord, into the past. And Lord, help us, knowing that You've been faithful, to trust You and Your faithfulness to the future. Lead us, Lord, to those things that we need to hold on to that will be useful for the future. Thank You for the truth of the gospel. Thank You for the good theology that You have given to us. Thank You, Lord, for the sacrifices that many people in this room have made so that those things can be preserved amongst us. Thank You, Lord. Thank You for the methods that You have given us to reach our communities in the past. Help us, Lord, to hold on to the things that will be helpful with those methods for the future. Help us to be graceful, O God, to let go of the things that we need to let go of the way we've always done, so that we can create the new that we need to do in this new ground that we're pioneering to reach people. All of us, Lord, we feel the tension. We want to be comfortable, but we know deep down that You're calling us to sacrifice so that people can believe the gospel. Help us, Lord, to make that sacrifice and to do so and begin so, Lord, today. We love You, Lord, and thank You that You are the God who hears prayer. And we bring before You, Lord, our sister Jan And Lord, just as you delivered her once from cancer, we pray, Jesus, that you would do so once again. Stretch out your hand to heal. We pray for our brother Tom, Lord, as he's continuing treatments. He's been hurting for a year or more. Lord, would you stretch out your hand and bring healing to him? And Lord, for our sister Myrtle, who's received this, or experienced a serious stroke. We don't know where her health is today, but Jesus, we pray that you will be gracious and kind to her. If her days are long, Lord, we pray that they would be quality. If her days are short, Lord, we pray that, Lord, you will give her peace. For Norma and for Bob, Lord, who stand back rather shocked and surprised, be gracious and kind unto them. And give them wisdom, Lord, how to care for Myrtle the best that they can. Lord, we lift these folks into your hands and our prayer before you this day. We love you, Lord, and lift our hearts to you. In your great and awesome name we pray. And all God's people said, amen.